Right. So Chimeron Bio, we are an early stage biotech, and we typically hear of technologies coming out of academia forming or leading to the formation of companies. I'm here to share our story, which is slightly different because our technology comes from the National Institutes of Health. It's a federally regulated body with its own challenges, but I'll also emphasize with its own advantages. And you know, the purpose of the talk is really to say, kind of share with you what we're up to, but in case anybody is interested in pursuing this path, we'll be very happy to share additional information with you. Okay, I'll just use this. So our mission is to develop RNA therapies. We are dedicated to RNA therapeutics largely because of what our platform allows us to do. We engineer synthetic nanoparticles which carry self-amplifying RNA, and the difference is it can deliver that RNA in a tissue-targeted manner. And I will break this down for you when we talk more about our technology, but as we were doing our due diligence, we really fell in love with it. We were super excited, and we wanted to pursue this further because, as we know, when you're trying to start a company, it's just not how you feel about it, but the product needs to be relevant. And I believe we really kind of got lucky there because cell and gene therapy is definitely experiencing a wave. It has been there in the field for quite some time, but it's probably all the technological advancements that have happened over the past 5 to 10 years that have now really culminated to what we are seeing as approval. We had CAR-T a couple of years back, and just a couple of days back, we have Spark Therapeutics, a gene therapy company in Philadelphia area, entering into a deal with Roche, estimated to be around $4.5 billion. And definitely in between, we have had approval for eye, as well as more to follow soon. So the area is definitely garnering a lot of attention. And what really favors us is the fact that RNA, which as such was lagging, now seems to be one of the fastest growing area in that bucket. And there are some obvious reasons the way we see it. First of all, RNA is very versatile. And that means we have mRNA, siRNA, microRNA, CRISPR. So there's more you can do with this entity. And unlike DNA, RNA does not integrate. So clinically, what all this means, hopefully, is the fact that you can broaden the repertoire of druggable targets. Targets which until now was not accessible, let's say, by small molecules or antibodies, now you can aspire to go after them with RNA. Having said that, like anything, it also has its challenges. One of the biggest challenge when it comes to RNA is the fact that it's highly unstable, or we can say it's largely unstable, so you really do need to package it stably. And when we talk of packaging, the most common methods we are seeing is packaging of the RNA inside liposomes, liposome-coated vehicles. But when we start doing that, we get into the problem of how do we target it to the tissue. So these are some of the challenges we think our technology can address. And so what are we really? We are a company, as I just mentioned, early stage. We have our RNA delivery platform technology, which we call CHASER. We have a first product in the field of immuno-oncology coming out of that platform, which is currently under preclinical development. So far, the work that we have done is largely funded by private investment, and more recently, we've got some money from New York State and pharmaceuticals. And we have a dual presence. We are present in both Philadelphia and in New York. So yes, although we are originally from Philadelphia, we are really trying to come to New York City. And we have a small team at this point. We have Tim Chandrimada, our CSO, and I'm the CEO. But between the two of us, we have more than 20 years of pharma experience. As such, we are PhD scientists. And more recently, we also got our MBA from Columbia Business School right here in the city. You look like a friendly crowd, so I feel bad marketing to you, but I am marketing to you. We are really good. So, the fact is, and I will talk about our start again in a couple of slides, but I just want to, for now, leave you with the thought that when Tim, when the co-founders, when we saw this technology, we just fell in love with. So I thought we should first talk about the technology before we talk about our start. So what our CHASER platform essentially comprises is we stably package our target RNA, which, by the way, can be any of the entities I mentioned. It could be mRNA, it could be siRNA, microRNA. So we take that, stably package it inside an envelope of viral glycoproteins, which are modified to express ligands, which can take or direct the vehicle to the tissue of choice. So it's not like taking a particle and trying to do some covalent binding interactions outside. This is inherent. Our tissue targeting is inherent to the particle. So hopefully with the packaging, we are addressing the stability issue of the RNA molecule. And by targeting, we really create a repertoire of molecules that can go to various tissues. And the way it works is once, so this is the potential of the particles, and once the RNA is delivered into the host cell, now here again I'll use the word self-amplifying RNA, that's inherent property of some small viruses, where what happens, one copy of RNA upon entry into the host cell can actually make multiple copies. So you can imagine what we end up getting is an amplified response. So very often people ask us, how are you different from mRNA? And my simplistic answer is, an mRNA, you deliver one copy, you end up with one copy and one protein. Here we get an amplified response. So again, clinically, what this could mean is a better pharmacological, or rather a greater dynamics when it comes to pharmacology. So a greater exposure with a lower dose, and hopefully, therefore, lesser side effects. And because of all these properties, we believe, if developed properly, we can really position ourselves as a first-in-class molecule. And I've already talked about the tissue targeting and self-amplification, and just some of the other distinguishing feature is the fact that it's what we deliver. So again, it's not one mRNA molecule, but we can actually deliver multiple mRNAs, and by that I mean multiple mRNAs for the gene. So you can deliver 3, 4, 5 genes at the same time, but most importantly, you can deliver different types of RNA entities. So you can deliver mRNA and an siRNA. Imagine a heterogeneous disease where you want to modulate a pathway, you want to upregulate one gene and downregulate another. This allows that, so it's very versatile. And we know the manufacturing platform is scalable, and one of our biggest priority right now is to establish systemic delivery so we can really go after intravenous gene therapy formulation. And now let's go back to the start. And I mentioned that we recently got our MBA. A couple of years back, we got our MBA from Columbia Business School, and Chimeron was literally conceived in one of the classrooms where three classmates we met and we just started talking. We had complementary skill set. We were coming from pharma and academia, but even when it comes to pharma, somebody did development, somebody did discovery. So it was really complementary. We were all unified this passion to come up with a drug, and we said, let's go for it. And the reason we said, let's go for it, is because we were also aware of a licensing opportunity that the NCI not just presented that time, they actually have a mechanism to facilitate licensing of technologies for startups. However, I must say, it came with its advantages and challenges. The advantage is that once we convinced NCI that we were really, really serious about this, and we had the necessary skill set to take this forward, they were super collaborative, they were very helpful, and if anything, they guided us through the process, and also the licensing terms are indeed favorable for the startup. Less negotiation, because it's kind of already favorable, and the terms were fixed, so that was really good, and we got rights to the IP, so it's a global exclusive license, we own the IP. Where it was challenging is we, of course, had to show we were funded. And imagine trying to raise money on a concept, leave alone the data. We had no data, it's just a concept. But you know, our private investors, they came through, so we overcame the hurdle, we got that. And the second challenge is, you really don't have access to the inventors, because again, it's in a federal body, you can't have the inventors as your consultants. it's just not very easy process. Once you get the license, the communication kind of stalls there. So you're kind of on your own, literally. Having said that, you know, that did not deter us. Maybe some of the fact we realized after the fact, but it's okay. And then we successfully executed the license in early 2017. And since then, we have been in operation. And when I say operations, how we really first started was this hot desk concept. Everything was virtual. Because there were things like, okay, what kind of studies do we have to execute? All that planning, and who do we work with, that background, who manufactures our agents? So there were all these questions, and we sorted that out in a hot desk model, 100% virtual model. And although today we have shifted, we are no longer 100% virtual, but you know, the fact is, during this journey, we have generated data which has allowed us a seat at the table with some very prominent groups. And I think the key to that success really has been the identification of very solid external partners / CROs, however we call them. Coming from pharma, Tim and I, we really respect how complex drug development can be, and we know how much we rely on our metrics team, because various functions come in and give you advice. And we see a quality CRO literally as an extension of that. They are our virtual metrics team members. And I'm really happy to highlight that CRL is one of our key partners. So thank you. And moving to where we are currently, what we realized when we started working 100% virtual is that not every aspect of it was very efficient. So when you have the studies figured out, it's perfect to outsource. But what do you do when it comes to assay development, protocol development? You need to do those in-house. And we also realize we need to retain those for our IP purposes. So now we have a fully functional lab, and our ratio of external to internal, or rather internal to external, is about 30-70. And you know, we are now able to have greater adherence to timelines, and we're also building up capability. So that was kind of the operations. And what we have really done from the time we got the license and we raised the money is us started with very basic feasibility questions, because in the earlier talk, we heard about de-risking. So yes, we are not at all de-risked, but we know how to de-risk. So that was our approach. Let's start with basic questions. Can we even make this? Is the protocol for formulation manufacturing even scalable? And once we're putting our gene inside in vivo, or a cell line in vitro, is it even doing anything? It was like those very simple questions. As you can see, most of our time resources, like almost 75% of our resources, went to addressing some early feasibility questions. And using our immuno-oncology agent as the test, what we confirmed is that indeed, aligned with the biology of self-amplification or self-amplifying RNA, we indeed have very stable gene expression in vivo, here detected or shown as a brown protein on the left panel, detected 21 days after treatment. That's very long kinetics. Again, it should not be super surprising to the self-amplifying RNA group. Then, next thing we asked, in those same tumors, we wanted to see if we have pharmacodynamic activity. In our case, CD4 and CD8 tumor infiltrating cells were the markers, and indeed, upon treatment, we see significantly increased recruitment. In the middle panel, I'm showing some early efficacy data on tumors, mouse tumors. We do see differential effect upon treatment, and of course, now the goal is to do dose optimization and really go aggressive with these models and understand efficacy. And finally, and to me, the most exciting part was the translational data, where we took human tumor cells, and then the question was, if we take our human tumor cells and take human immune precursors, PBMCs, and treat with our agent, would we have any effect? And as you can see in the blue line, indeed, treatment with our agent has a much superior effect compared to control. So these were only, of course, feasibility questions that we have addressed or just started addressing. We have much more to do. But now we're also starting to think, okay, what should be our expansion plan? So while immuno-oncology is fantastic, but this platform definitely has potential way beyond oncology. So, and we are already starting to explore infectious diseases, genetic disorders, but most importantly, we think we can go beyond human application, because in veterinary agricultural field, there's a tremendous need for new vaccines, and we believe we can have a part there too. And how do we plan to execute our strategy? It's nice to say this is what we plan to do, but how exactly are we going to do it? And this is, you know, this has been one of our most, interesting learning experience. We thought once we, of course, we started with the impression we are very great. I mean, everything would be easy, but it was absolutely to the contrary. So once we got the license, we thought, all right, private investors, then VC, and then down the road, you try to get a pharma partner, and hopefully that's how you license, exit, whatever. We thought that's the path. But very interestingly, what we are now starting to see, so we were always open-minded. We said we'll try to have our equity investment, but we'll also try to have the pharma collaborations. And where we are actually getting traction are with private investors and pharma. So we are already under discussion with two pharma. With one, it's the R&D proposal is drafted. I think we are very close to executing. And although I come from pharma, this was a bit of a surprise for us because we thought it should really be more late stage, but no. Where we got the traction was the fact they appreciated how early we approached them. That means now they get to take part in the development of their targets. We were not coming to them with a fixed idea, a fixed product, but it's very flexible. It's like an open platform. And so we are looking forward to executing that. And in the meantime, there's a second pharma. This is a siRNA company. They're interested in tissue targeting, targeted delivery. And so we're starting to engage with them. And at this point, the equity investment looks like, once again, we'll have to rely on private investors. And we do have some good lead, but not all the leads are from this country. We had to go outside. And so I would like to also emphasize a bit about our key challenges and learning, because again, you know, the ones who are established, really great. We would love to be in your seats, but the ones who are just starting out, maybe you can get some help from our learning. So the fact is, you have to recognize that when you're starting ground up, it is going to be difficult because the investment community expects de-risk product. And when you're starting from scratch, you're not de-risk. We do not have the luxury of academic ties. We have pharma people who quit our job because that's how much we believe in it. We have our training, we believe in the potential, we believe in the commercial appeal. So we've decided to do, so it's a little harder because there was literally no data at the time of licensing. The second learning has been around messaging. When I was speaking with a community, for me, I thought CB101 is just so attractive and so appealing. It's immuno-oncology and everybody is doing that, and I'm from that space. But interestingly, what we are learning, while our partners like that, they're more interested in the platform because they want to develop their own targets. And so that learning has been really very helpful. In other words, we were underestimating our own potential. The third point, and which I truly believe in, especially since the onus of de-risking is on us, be realistic, be objective about your data. Tim and I would say that's a culture of Chimeron, for us, we are always looking to kill the program. And I'm very sorry to say, or happy to say, we have fared poorly there. We are not finding any reason to kill the program yet. What feasibility questions we start off with, somehow it's panning out. But you know, we have to be objective about our data. That's the only way we can push a good product. And be open-minded. And this aspect comes from everything, from when you're trying to raise money, what terms you may be presented. You may not be happy with it. You may be surprised with it. We actually already had an acquisition deal that we declined because for once we got to tell them, sorry, you're too early. That's generally what we get to hear. And that also told us that, no, we really believe in this and we're going to go for it. And the other open-mindedness comes from the investors. We all love to go with brand names, branded VCs, branded universities. But the fact is, you know, there are a lot of risk takers out there, and you just have to find the right partner. This applies to collaborations you're setting up, and this applies to the money you're trying to raise. And also, we have learned a lot from our virtual operations. While I acknowledge it's not possible to operate 100-person virtually, but we really like where we are at this point. And our goal is, as we grow, and we do intend to grow, we would like to stay lean so that the core company is not that big. We are not investing too much time on administrative matters, but can rather really put our attention to things like pipeline expansion. But of course, it's our responsibility to find good external partners. And finally, you know, the question of why New York City. Bill, our previous speaker, already addressed some of the great aspects of the city. I would just confirm some of those. You know, universities were always there, so definitely we have the universities, we have the KOLs, talent pool. It's a great investment community. But for a company like Chimeron Bio, which is not affiliated with the university, we do not have that umbrella of academic relationship. What makes a huge difference for us, or has made, is in the past 2 years, the premier incubator spaces that have come up in the city. So now we have space to work with because we are literally absolutely independent entity working with the technology that comes from the NIH. So this, the incubator space, makes a huge difference for us, and also the boutique CROs that are in not only in the city, but in the state at large. We have some very good companies here. They offer specialized service, and it makes a difference to companies like us. And I can't leave without acknowledging our external CROs. You know, for a startup, that means so much to have good CROs standing by you and saying, it's okay, just keep doing it. So we have that support, and also our external investors. And finally, while I do not have an acknowledgement slide per se, I do want to leave the audience with my interpretation of probably what Walt Disney was trying to say about Mickey Mouse. The way I look at it is, it's okay to start small. It's okay. It's okay to meet skeptics. It's okay to be told you're too early. It doesn't matter who tells you what. The question is, do we believe in the science? Absolutely. And are we going to work hard and go however far we have to raise money to execute our plan? The intention is there, so we absolutely intend to. We'll see where we end up. And the reason this intention is there, because, you know, that's our pharma training. End of the day, we are doing this because we know patients are waiting. And I think that's really the biggest driver for Chimeron Bio, and I want that to be our culture. And with that, I thank you for your patience and open the floor for questions.
Questions?
Hi, Jolly.
Hi, Tony.
You talked a little bit about having surprises along the way, and I mean, I know, I don't think it's on, is it? Okay, it's on now. I know a bit about the story of how you guys have evolved and grown and the resilience that you've to keep going with the company. And this is not a Charles River commercial, by the way, although we do partner. So could you say a little bit more about the kinds of surprises that you've found along the way and what's kept you going? Because I think for people in the audience who are like at an earlier stage, absolutely, like you guys are, how to, like, it's the inspiration.
So some of the, some of the surprises were out of our control. And I can't say some surprises were under our control, but what I'm trying to say, there were flaws internally too that was definitely under our control. So the external surprise, the first one was, you know, the incubator, one of the incubator space we had a relationship with when we were under the impression, wrong impression probably, that there was a seed platform and resident companies would be put on that platform. And that was not exactly true. The intent, I always believe, you know, that's one thing I've realized. People, I think, mean well. There's always the intention, but the timing may not be what they think it is. So we took some of those decisions based on that expectation that it's going to work out, and I don't think any seed platform was ready. The second surprise was the pharma collaboration I mentioned. By now, I should have actually been standing and saying, we got it, we got done. So we had, the R&D side was not a problem, but we did face a glitch with the accounting side. So again, we're trying to work it out. And so these are some external things that I think were kind of outside our control. Internally, I'll be very honest, we did not do a great job with accounting. We triggered a study when we thought we had some money in the bank, and apparently that was not the case. So that was purely our fault. And the only reason, I'm sharing this, and to your question, Tony, we feel we should keep going, because as long as we recognize our weakness, our mistakes, and we are willing to take ownership and we are willing to work towards it, I think there's no reason to stop. And I think transparency is important. We have been very transparent with our partners, and that's our culture, trust, relationship, and end of the day, it's really driven by the science. We believe that the timing is so relevant. It goes back to Bill's point that that's what we have heard. You're so new. I mean, why should we invest in you? Indeed, we are very new, but guess what? If you're successful, we'll lead the path. It will be a paradigm shift. And I want to be realistic about that. That's why I'm saying, if we are successful, I mean, it's just fight, and we'll keep going. And I think we're doing okay. It's on the contrary, absolutely, on the contrary. So again, that's where the open-mindedness and the objectiveness comes. You have to believe in your training. You can't lie about that. You have to believe in the data, no lying about that. And you've got to constantly challenge each other. So our team initially, it was always a small team, 3 members, but we really work very closely with a lot of people. So we are getting constant feedback. You do not want to work in isolation.
Thank you so much, Jolly. Right now we're going to be heading out for a break.